So much of what I have focused on is focused on trying to figure out how I can help and kids in particular, kids and youth. And it's been a really a journey for me of something that I needed to do, because in my early years, I was a real struggling kid. And I remember it's grade seven was what I wanted to focus on when I first began, because at grade seven, I felt quite alone. And so that's where I started in my education degree. But in high school, things got messy. In fact, I dropped out twice, and now I look back and thanks to science, finding my way to Stuart Shanker, and finding his understanding of self-regulation and grounded in the science, I came to it first trying to help the kids that I worked with. It began changing how I was. It's changed who I am as a person. It's changed how I parent. And I'm just really grateful for a chance to share a little bit with you tonight. So if you see on this opening slide here, there is take a snapshot. You're welcome to take snapshots of anything here. But there's a link there that if you click on it, you'll find a notes version of these slides and some other resources for you as well. So the first thing I want to just say is, why are we so worried about kids and teens? When I think about the organization that's hosting this, Aaron Mills Connects, and they're coming together in 2016, 40 partners. What were they surrounded? What were they coming together around? It was the well-being of young people and families. So that's a really, really important thing to remember. We know that the pandemic is part of it. We know that I like to think of it as like bumping everything up an octave, or down an octave. If you were struggling before, it made things heavier for a lot of people. And yet we know that in my work around behaviors was one of my areas of being a specialist in, that the challenges were growing. I mean, people that I was presenting to back then, I would ask, is they, for those of you that have been educators or working supporting parents, or parents of multiple kids, are you finding things more or less the same, or do they feel like they're getting worse? And for sure, there's a various responses to questions like that. For sure there are. There's lots of kids that are doing just fine and some thriving. Lots of parents, educators that are just thriving, ECEs, and yet over and over and over again, I would hear that something's different. It's more challenging. There's more things going on. We'll talk a little bit about that. I am going to go, I know we focused on strategies, and there are definitely some strategies in here in tonight's talk, but I really want to get into the Q&A, the hard questions, but we have to give a little something to hang our hat on. About 2 months ago, I was giving a talk in Manitoba for an organization there. And at the end of my talk, an elder came up and hugged me. I was actually quite taken, she was so warm and I wasn't expecting it. And she began crying and she told me, she thanked me for suffering. She found some hope in all of this, but she also told me she was so worried about her kids or grandkids and the kids of her community and how things had gotten so much worse. And I know the community in the Klitschko community where I lived in the Northwest Territories for 7 years, where my daughter was born, the tragedies that I'm hearing there, things have gotten worse. When I was on the phone yesterday with a group from Australia that are doing work with early years. And the message is the same. Children are really struggling. We're seeing in the news, if you look at the research, it's suggesting we're in a crisis with teenagers. I promise to make this positive for you, and I promise to give you some hope, because there is lots of hope. But it's real. It's real. This is not just our imagination. Something is going on. And when we ask questions like that, right? When we begin to say, "Why are we so worried about our kids?" My daughter's 15 now. She's doing okay. But let me tell you, 14 was a year, right? And the friends and the things that I'm hearing in the groups and everywhere that we work over and over again, the challenges are bigger. You know, we're dealing with more things than we used to. And what do we do about it? What do we do about it? So it's really important when I say something like that, that it's very easy to hear that and say, the problem is parenting. We just need to be tougher on kids. Yeah. When you begin to actually dive into the science, kids need boundaries, absolutely, and expectations and all of those things. It's important for their well-being, and they need love. Love is one of the messages I want to give you tonight. But this isn't just a parenting issue. Oh, the problem is schools, and schools are struggling. Educators are struggling. Are there lots of things that could be done differently and improve? Yeah, but it's not just schools. It's everywhere. And it's almost like we are floating. All of us are living in this toxic soup, you know, and with stressors that are going, right? And so we're having more and more to deal with. So often, you know, we begin thinking that, well, kids have it easier these days. And it depends on your lens on that. If you're looking at the neurobiological lens of stress, we realize that their stress systems are running on empty, and it's a big part of what we're dealing with. So I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about that lens of self-regulation. There are different definitions of self-regulation. I got the report card for my kiddo yesterday and her, you know, whatever on self-regulation as a grade nine student. And yet there are 447 different definitions. So they are connected. And the work that I'm going to present you is very related. For me, it's the hope. It is absolutely the hope. And yet it's the original science definition. So it is a very different understanding. We begin to look at the roots instead of trying to work on behavior and trying some of these approaches to managing that aren't working so well anymore and maybe haven't worked for a long time for a number of people. So there will be a point in just a few minutes where I can take a few questions, and I'll do that at a few points throughout, and then we'll do cues at the very end. So here's what I want you to know. Excessive stress is part of the story. It absolutely is. Stress is not the enemy. You couldn't get rid of it if you wanted to, because stress is actually a part of how our brain and bodies navigate the world. And it's necessary. There is a stress response in your body when you wake up in the morning and you get a bit of cortisol, you know, that you have a little bit of an energy burst. So there are stress is just a part of being a human being. Learning, new learning is stress, right? It can challenge us. Maybe we have a bit of a cognitive dissonance is the language for it, but we have something we really believed, and then somebody shows us information or new research or a story that is different. It doesn't match. And that's, you know, it causes tension. And actually that's a stressor, right? We burn a ton of energy, glucose, just trying to figure out how that works. So stress is actually very positive. It's too much stress and not enough strategies. And by that, I don't just mean I should go and do yoga right now, or go and take some deep breaths, or, you know, count to 10, those things that we might think out loud as stressors, as strategies. It's having the internal resources, and it is also the external things that are around us as well. So it's part of it. If you've ever wondered, you know, if you have a kid that you have been told lacks empathy, right? Or if, you know, those joining as educators, you know, I used to always hear this kid has flat affect. So it means that not showing any emotion. And we're wondering what happened to the empathy, and definitely modeling and exposing kids to empathy. And these are parts of our roles as parents and caregivers and family members, right? We're helping shape how our kids see the world by sharing how we see the world and helping in so many different ways. And yet what happens when that empathy goes away? It can be very confusing, right? Because as a parent, you might say, oh no, what kind of kid am I raising, right? Same thing when you're at the store, you're at a big box store and your kid's having a meltdown at the cash register, right? And you're like, oh, what kind of kid am I raising? And all these people are watching and so on. And it can shake you because you're beginning to think, I don't, what kind of kid, you know, morals and values and all, and good citizenship and these sorts of things. So where the flip is and where the hope is that from the science perspective, so that's the neurophysiology, what happens in our brains and bodies, which is, I'm not a neuroscientist, I'm an educator and a mom and a business leader, I guess, in a way. But I like thinking about how the science can help me understand. A whole bunch of things happen under excessive stress. And one of them is connected to the it connects the nerves to the face. There's cranial nerves in the face, 5 cranial nerves that are wrapped up in a nerve that is the vagus nerve, and it's actually meant to help us with a parasympathetic, so a calming response, but also, you know, excessive stress response. And it affects the muscles of the face. So you literally, you know, we can't do this. We don't see the smile lines. Our voice becomes very monotone. And there's all sorts of, it changes how our ears work. So if you're seeing a lack of empathy in our work, we would say, what's blocking that? What's blocking that? What's blocking that? Teachable moments for kids who are doing that and we're not noticing it in, or our partners, or maybe even ourselves. Where does it go when it goes out the window? I'm this good person all day long, and then I'm like snapping at my own kids or judging that person down the road. Does that mean I'm not a good person? You are a good person. You don't show up to something like this on an evening off if you're not trying to be part of the solution. We have finite batteries. They run on empty. Our brain changes state, and guess what? It can shut off the part of the brain that's needed to feel empathy for others, because we're in a survival state. So it helps us understand so many things. So if you're hearing that your kid's not paying attention in school, whether there's diagnoses or not, we work with all sorts of folks with all sorts of different diagnoses, and our team is full of neurodiverse people, including me. Well, I got a couple of diagnoses in there, right? So, right, and it that's separate from it. Stress is actually a big, big part of the ability to pay attention. And so what we tend to do is say, you need to pay attention. How well does that work for you? It doesn't, right? Or you're trying to get a kid to do homework at a certain time of night, or you want your 3-year-old or your 4-year-old to do whatever it is you want them to do. Or you have a child in university that's supposed to be studying or in college or whatever, and they're just vegging out on the video games all day. What do you do? Well, the very first thing we do is recognize there's something more going on. Why and why now? Why and why now? So stress is a part of the story. We have stressors in 5 domains. Right now, if I think about my daughter, who's 15, and so she's got the stress of being a 15-year-old girl. She has a boyfriend, which, you know, there's stressors in that domain. I have to really watch her, make sure she's drinking water. You know, when it was hot last week, that heat is a stressor. Lack of sleep is a stressor. Not being outside in nature and moving enough. These are all stressors. People who deal with chronic pain. Just think about the last time you were sick, and how did that affect your parenting or your teaching? Right? How did it? Of course, you did okay, but you were like 80% there. Well, it's not just when we're sick. It's when these stressors are weighing us down, thinking about like stress backpacks. So emotion stressors. So this is not emotion regulation. So it's not managing or suppressing our emotion. All of those things matter sometimes. This is about at the root of that. What we do is we realize that strong emotions are energy gobblers. They gobble up glucose. And it's not just, I don't think in negative and positive emotions. Every emotion serves a purpose, and it happens to us. We're not choosing emotions, right? We can recognize them for sure. But it's realizing that the super excitement, the first day of school, or super excitement, tomorrow is Halloween, or whatever your faith is, the holidays and the celebrations in your faith. So excited, right? And that's the night that at 10 o'clock at night, you're having complete meltdowns. Bad kid? No. It's literally, the energy is completely bottomed out. It's changed their brain state. It's changed their physiological state. And it's part of what we're seeing in front of us. And you might say, how does that help me? Well, here's the thing. If I don't realize that there's more going on with my kid and with compassion, and sometimes it's really hard and we're human. And look, I this is what I do. You know, I've been doing it with Stuart for 10 years and I know a lot. I don't know everything. I learn something new every week from Stuart especially, but also from others in the communities we serve. But I still get it wrong as a parent. I catch myself going, because I'm a human being and I have a stress response system. And when we begin to realize, okay, wait a minute, that wasn't rational. Why and why now? We can have both compassion for ourselves. We see our kids differently. Their brain and bodies actually pick up the changed state. An elder gave me, from the Northwest Territories, gave me the language of soft eyes. They don't feel as threatened, but also in the end, we tend to resolve things quicker. So this is not about, oh, no problem, you threw a rock at your cousin. No problem, you've just had a really stressful time. No, that's not okay. That's not okay, but I can say that with love. And I can also say that in a way that says, we're gonna resolve it, but I'm not gonna start talking at you right now, because I know that part of your brain is probably not even processing, right? That's a sign to me that something's not okay. And how do I deal with it in different kinds of ways? So it does reduce it. People who learn, who really go further in the journey and learn a lot more self-reg than I can do in a 45 minute or talk or so, it, you know, they begin to ask different questions. Why and why now? They're always curious. What more is going on? Because there is always something more beneath the surface. Social stressors. You know, some of you love to be around other people when you're having a hard time. If you're like me, I'm the very opposite, a bit introverted, although I love being around kids and I love doing this work and I'm not, I guess, shy or whatever. I'm very comfortable with it. But socially, I'm the awkward duckling at the, you know, at the dinner party or whatever, right? So a little bit. And social stressors, right? Not being able to read the cues of others or the get the jokes. And this is really hard on many of our kids, right? Social stressors were a big part of why COVID was so hard on our kids. And we need compassion for that. Many of the kids missed out on some key points, right? On some key points in their development. Right. And does that mean that they can't make up for that? No, they can. But when we look and say, you're 15, you should. And we're like, wait a minute. They've also had a really hard time. They lost. It's such an important period of time to have those social relationships. So social stressors, pro-social stress, taking on the other, on the stress of others. If you see things in the news and they hurt your heart. Right. That's pro-social stress. If you're worried about a loved one, right, that can also be pro-social stress. If you're a sense of injustice about anything, that's pro-social stress. And so is empathy. It's a very expensive emotion. So there's all kinds of stressors in all the domains. So I'll just show you this as an example. If you look at the one in the center, that's a ride at a fair or a fair of some kind or a park of some kind. And I just want you to notice, would you love that? Would you hate that? See, for me, I'm a thrill seeker, but I get dizzy. So that does not look fun to me. But here's the thing, gravity is a stressor. So like, this is the idea that some things you will know that they are stressors on kids and you. Others, we forget the little things that make a difference. Gravity, that's why you burn a certain number of calories every day just for being awake, because your body is dealing, it's responding to all these stressors, and it's trying to keep your brain and body I like thinking of it, this idea of, it's Dan Siegel's idea, but the window of tolerance, but it's also these homeostasis in all these different areas. So our blood sugar needs to be just so, or certain things happen. You know, we need a certain amount of oxygen. We need our blood pressure at a certain rate. So it's all of these different areas that are working on the brain and body. But it's not just biological stressors like gravity, emotion stressors, scared, right? If that's terrifying, pro-social stressors, you're worried about other people thinking, you know, let's say you're worried about them judging you as being a wimp or whatever, whatever language they might use. Social stressors, being around so many people, right? There's the cognitive stressors, which I didn't get to, but just think about what happens with tax time, right? What happens to you? So we have stressors happening around us all the time. I want you to look at the circle on the left. And if you've with somebody else, or, you know, just go ahead and you know, think about, do you love this? Would you hate this? Could you explain it to someone else? If we were together in a group, I would ask you that. And there would be some people's hands who would fly up that they love this, right? There would probably be, there's some people that were, it's okay. And then there would be a whole group of people that hated it. It was like, right? Math anxiety, high math anxiety is actually being researched, why our brains are having responses like, you know, there's a bear chasing us to math. So it's not just about making good decisions and self-control. It's realizing this is operating on our brain and creating a stress response that says, this is a threat. This is a threat. If it makes you feel any better, I had to ask Stuart, I knew it was five. I mean, you could figure out that each equation equals five, but I had to ask him how that one worked. So, and I have, like, you know, I have degrees that have math in them, you know, so it's realizing that math can be a stressor. So, you know, those of you that have tried to do homework, it's interesting for me doing homework with my kid, because I taught so many kids over the years, and I taught a lot of math. And the one kid that I can't teach math to is my own, right? And it would be really interesting. She would shut down. She has high math anxiety. She does okay. But if she doesn't know what to do, she shuts down so fast. And then I would have a response and justice, and, you know, I'm not my greatest mom moment. So this isn't about solving that. There's all kinds of self-reg ways that I tried and you can work on. It's just recognizing, okay, stressors are not just, I owe money, somebody's expecting something from me. You know, I'm having relationship issues. It's not just those things. It's also things that are operating on our brain and body all the time. One more example of stress.
We just went through the drive-up window. What did we get, Cooper? Daisy, what did we get at the drive-up window? No, Cooper, let Daisy have some. No, Cooper. Daisy, where did we go? Did we go to McDonald's? No. Daisy gets hers first. Why does Daisy get hers first? Because Cooper eats his too fast.
So if you found yourself saying, aw, you know, which some of you may have, and again, individual differences, there's no right or wrong here, but if you found yourself saying, aw, feeling bad for Cooper, even if you knew there was something coming, that is pro-social stress. Right? That's when we take on the stress of others. We're worried, we feel bad for Cooper, right? And so it's really interesting to think about how stressors are energy gobblers, not just on kids, on all of us as well, right? This is an idea that Stuart Shanker wrote about in his 2016 book for parents, which is just called Self-Reg. And this is a stress cycle. So here's the other thing. When we begin to realize that excess stress, too much, is part of the problem. And again, if kids are thriving or you're thriving, this doesn't need much thought, because you're already doing some of it naturally. It's when kids are not doing okay, right? Or we're not doing okay. That's when you begin to really need self-reg. I'm doing okay, and I still find self-reg adds to my life. It adds to my understanding. It helps in so many different ways. I respond so differently than I used to just a decade ago. So this is the stress cycle. So it's remembering that these are not individual. I'm biological. I haven't, you know, I've got a teenager, and she hasn't had enough sleep, and she suffers from headaches. And, you know, she sleeps with the light on because she's getting, you know, having a hard time sleeping at night. So she's not you know, rested, properly rested. And how do you know? It's not a specific amount of time, although I support all of the recommendations about sleep. How do you know? Look at how they are when they get up in the morning. That's what tells you if they're in a reasonable mood, right? They've had enough sleep. So you begin to look for some of these signs. But then if that happens, she goes to school and does math. I just told you the high math anxiety, and she's having a harder time focusing and, keeping the working memory. It affects all sorts of areas of memory. And then emotion, she begins to feel anxiety rising in her or worry or fear that the teacher is going to call on her. And then she begins, it begins affecting her ability to read the cues of others. When I'm really stressed, I sometimes miss cues of others. When most of the time I'm kind of hyper-focused on changes on people, I pick them up really quickly. It goes out the window, and it goes on and on. So that's the idea. It's not just one thing. It's the stressors. And some of us get caught in a stress cycle. That's not, I had a bad day or I had a rough couple of days. And this is like, this has been ongoing for some time and I'm not feeling well, or I'm not seeing my child feeling well, or, for vast periods of time, and we can be stuck in this stress cycle. It's also hopeful because we can't get rid of all the stressors. I can't decide that my kid doesn't need to do math. I wouldn't suggest that the five-year-old who doesn't ever want to go to school because it's overwhelming, that the solution is to not go to school unless you choose homeschooling, which is totally your choice. But it's not necessarily taking that approach. It's saying, okay, here are the things you need to do. Here are the stressors this is just part of being a human being. And expectations, for example, are stressors, but they're also provide structure. It's removing the ones that aren't serving anything. And oftentimes that can be us. We don't even realize it. But we're trying to remove, dial down some of the stress that you can. And sometimes it's the little ones that you haven't thought anything about. Something as simple as, for me, turning out the lights. I feel a right? And so I'm not saying that's going to solve all your problems, but beginning to think like that. So I just wanted to add a couple more just snippets of science. I'm not going to do justice to these. There are courses. There's lots of free videos and things online where you can learn more about all of these. But this is the triune brain. It's a metaphor, okay? So if there's neuroscientists saying that it's not an accurate depiction of the brain, it's not, right? It really isn't. And the neuroscience is mind-blowing and so exciting right now because there's something new coming out every week. Some of the earlier assumptions about this, this triune metaphor are being shown to perhaps not be accurate or definitely not. Pieces of it have been misunderstood for sure. But the general thing that I like as a parent and an educator is this idea of thinking about it as states, brain states. So when I'm in a blue brain state, okay, I like Dan Siegel's model. He does a hand model like this. And so he talks about this top part as being the blue brain. And he uses different language. Blue brain is what we use. But that's the thinking brain, and that's language, and that's I can reappraise. I said no to something just a few minutes ago. And then I gave it some thought and changed my mind, and I can do that. It's reappraisal. So it tells you that the part of the brain that you need to make good decisions, make choices, to catch yourself doing that, is online. And when it's online, everything else in the brain is working in synchrony, doing the things it needs to do, taking care of digestion, scanning for safety and threat, all these sorts of things that are happening. The part of our brain that is about parts of our brain that are looking for connection and so on. So all of that is great. The problem is, under stress, we do, this is Dan Siegel's idea. It's just a metaphor again for understanding, but I've shown this to three-year-old kids, right? You flipped your lid, and it basically, it's way more complex than this, but it means that the thinking part of your brain, the rational part of your brain, it has gone offline largely, and the lower parts of the brain are running the show. And so that's really important. When we think about a red brain state, It's not, red brain is not the enemy. It's not the, oh, we avoid it. If you're really into any kind of sports right now, right, that gets the red brain up. If you love going to concerts or theater, you know, that all involves the red brain, right? It's an energizing, it's connection. Kids play. It's why play is so important in the early years. It's not an add-on or an extra. It's how they learn, right? When you're looking at challenges that are happening with older kids, and you choose to stand back for a little and they problem solve and figure things out, even if it gets a bit tense, you know, those are all red brain states that can go in, you know, be done in a positive kind of way. But when it takes over, you know, that's when we hear the fight, flight, you know, we recognize those. The ideas have evolved, or the research has evolved way beyond just fight and flight. But, you know, those states that we see, right? The kid that tells us we're mad at them and we really aren't, right? Or you're thinking bad things about me, or someone we love that tells us they hate us and they don't mean that. It's like a verbal punch that's coming out of that state. And the gray brain is really interesting because it is, it is all of it's the most ancient part of our brain, and it's the survival mechanisms. It keeps a whole lot of things functioning. It's a big part of our heart and our breathing, and it's where the chemicals are released for fight or flight, for example. But here's the thing, its job, this is the interesting thing, most interesting thing for me lately, that understanding, its job is to maintain homeostasis in a whole bunch of different areas. So you're saying, okay, what do you mean by homeostasis and why does it matter? Well, another word for homeostasis, when we want our kids to be calm, we want them to calm down, we want them to focus, their brain and body, if it's not in the state to be able to do that, and they don't choose that, right? It's called homeostatic imbalance. Just think of it as being out of the window. And we've got kids that are, you know, there's all kinds of ways that they're not in balance. And there's neuroscience in all of these different areas, you know, and these are some examples of behaviors. I want you to think of it like behaviors that are reactions, reflexive. You know, I hold my breath, right? My heart rate's going to go up, by the way. So if I hold my breath, you know, and I take my heart rate, it goes up. Everything we do and say and experience has impacts on our brain and body and our kids' brains and bodies. So then we're going to feel an urge to go, right? Which is a good thing. It's survival. But water, we get, you know, signs that of we have, don't have enough salt, or we have too much salt, or our body temperature. I'm 54 now, so I'm, you know, just gone, finished pretty well finishing up the hot flashes, right? But really it's experiencing some of the things that are happening in my body. When I get cold, I shiver. Well, the shivering actually creates a little bit of heat, uses up energy. So The social one is a newer understanding, that they found a neuron in the gray brain, basically, that we're seeking social engagement. Your kid that's saying, talk to me, or you're a teacher, miss, and you're like, oh, they're seeking connection. I love that. It's Jody Carrington sort of language, but the idea is there's a brain-based way. So I'm inviting you to think differently about your kid's behavior. I'll do this a little bit more next time, because there's a lot of strategies that can come out of this. But I just want you to think in your mind right now about, if you were going to rate your energy today, right now, on a scale of 1 to 10, and energy is not hyperactivity. Energy is, I feel good, I'm awake, you know, I can, whatever I'm going to do after tonight. So just on a 1 to 10, mine is very good. I'm probably an 8 or a 9 right now. Now I want you to rate your tension, physical tension. Ugh, everything hurts, you know, and thinking on that on a scale of 1 to 10. So some of you, you know, mine is higher. So my energy is good, but my tension is always high. Well, this is how it is with many of our kids. And so if you use this, it's four quadrants of a physiologist named Robert Thayer. It's part of Self-Reg. But most of us, the kids who are struggling, are always on the right-hand side of this. High energy, high tension is terrific for flow and work, and I'm in that state right now. But when we're stuck there, It takes its absolute wear and tear on our body. And so that's where you're getting behavior problems, right? And then you begin to see, we've got the kids with their monster drinks and technology and all sorts of things that are happening over, and not nearly enough time on the restorative side, which is on the left-hand side. We'll play with that more. I just want you to keep that idea in mind. So behavior is communication, is not just a fluffy, nice thing to say. Behavior is communication. Why and why now? And we've got to go beyond the ideas of seeking, you know, avoidance and seeking attention. It really, it's like, okay, avoidance, why? Why and why now? And we know there's something more going on beneath. And so some of the carrots and sticks ideas that we've used forever, sticker charts and rewards and punishments, and look, I've tried them too. They last for a little bit. The research is pretty solid that you can use them to change some behaviors some of the time, but it certainly isn't, as far as any science I've read and any lived experience I've had in all kinds of different contexts, it's not leading to where we need to be with kids. So our goal is not compliance. Do I want kids to basically be good citizens? Yeah. But I want them to want to do that. And I also want them in today's age, I want them to, we'd give a lot of talk about youth voice. I love that Aaron Mills has youth on their committee. What does that really mean? And it's not just token. And when we're looking at working with different communities and cultures, it's not just, and bringing in parents, if you're an educator, for example, what does voice mean? And we want to encourage people to stand up. And how do we do that? So really realizing that this is not about squashing behavior or getting in compliance. It's why and why now? Why and why now? So how do I know the difference between stress behavior and misbehavior? So this is the study. It's in child development in 2015, if you want to look it up. But there are 447 different definitions of self-regulation out there. So that's why what you see on the report card is different than what I'm saying, even though Stuart Shanker, my boss and the founder of all of this, was an advisor. It's still about managing your stuff and managing your behavior. And, you know, it's another word for managing yourself. But self-regulation here is not that, right? It is really about managing stress. So being able to manage the hard things, it's very tied to true resilience, and deal with disappointment, deal with things that we've got to overcome, and then restore on the other side, magic, right? So it's not self-control. Lots of, self-control is important. You're here, you practice self-control to be here. But what do we do when it's not available? For me, one of my, I'll call it weakness, but now I see it differently, is, I've had a healthy relationship with food, healthier relationship with food, thanks to living in Italy for 4 years. But it has definitely been, I've been a stress eater. And so what happens when I'm like, I decide I'm not going to have, I'm not going to eat junk food. I'm not going to do any of those things. I eat mostly healthy. It's better now, but it used to be not so good. And then I'm great. I have all the willpower in the world until 8 o'clock at night. Where'd it go? Oh, you don't have self-control. Actually, what happened was a dysregulated system, right? So, and then I had an urge and I felt momentarily better when I'm eating my chips, because of it literally releases opioids in the brain. So there's all these things that are happening with that maladaptive approach. And then I feel worse. So let's just have, we've all seen something like this happen. It's so sweet when you see a two-year-old, you almost think, I don't know if you think that's sweet, but for me, it was, it was warm. But think about our teenagers that do it, or adults that do it. We're really good at having the patience for those under two, and over 80, 75 or 80, and we forget in between that. So for there, it's frustration, right? Frustration is very dysregulating. If that was a 10-year-old, do we need to have a talk with them about, making better choices? Well, that wouldn't actually help, because they didn't choose that. It happened to them. Really important when we're thinking of helping our kids. So I just wanted to point out for teens. So I've got a couple of little images here. So one with numbers, you can try to turn those numbers around in your mind's eye. It's a math test, I guess, is something that you can, you know, have a look and see, do I love that? Is that like, oh, I do it for 2 seconds and then I stop? The one on the left is just taken from the Wordle craze, right? Do you love those kind of things or do you find them really frustrating? And there's a whole bunch of science around something called limbic braking, in the sense of we're doing, you know, we're working hard on something and then we just shut down. It looks like we give up, but our brain has actually said, the systems in our brain have said, you're burning too much energy, shut it down. So what do? You know, the very first thing we got to do is see kids differently. So, you know, this is part of the perfect storm for kids. They've got excess of stress. So COVID has added to that. Technology, it's not an accident that smartphones align with and why there's such a big push on technology and accountability in the various industries that are impacting our kids. I'm not anti-technology at all, but I am worried about it, and you know, so that's a big one. But there's excess of stress on our kids. You know, even losing your purpose is a stress if you think about that, right? Like, what is our purpose? What I'm doing matter? You know, that those actually begin to add stressors too. Maladaptive coping strategies. So I joked about my chips. It could be the wine or you know, alcohol. It could be shutting down and hibernating. you know, it can be video games. It could be gambling. There's all sorts of ways that things that we can do. Gossiping. You know, if you're gossiping about others, you actually feel better for a little bit. You get a little rush of probably oxytocin for whoever you're connecting with, and dopamine for telling the gossip. Then you feel worse, right? So it helps you cope with the stress. You actually helps with your body's homeostasis, but then you feel worse. Same for kids, they're getting in trouble. They're, you know, I'm a flyer. I'm running out of, you know, the early childhood center, or I just told my parents off, or I lied, and I'm hiding, I'm sneaking things, whatever it is that I'm doing. I'm fighting with my brothers and sisters. So all of this is lots of it is reaction. But you have to realize there's also urges that are happening in the brain and body, discomfort, if you will. And some of these strategies happen. And that's a problem, because these become stressors on kids. So anybody stuck in a stress cycle that's doing maladaptive coping feels worse and lacking in oxytocin. So there's a lot of cool stuff on this, but most people know that it's about, we think, mothers and infants and so on for oxytocin, as some people call it, the, you know, it's the love hormone, but it also has anti-stress effects. And so it can dial down, it can dampen stressor, it can dampen the stress response. And yet we're not connecting with one another. We're on our video games. Where are we? We're doing constant partial attention. Our parents are you know, on their phones all the time, maybe, right? So, and we're not realizing these things are part of it. So that's where self-reg comes in. So this is what self-reg is. It's a five domain framework, and it is five practices. Stuart calls them steps. I asked him if he was okay if I call them practices, and he is. And I just like thinking of that, because it's not clinical. It's not for somebody else to do. It's part of living. You know, I'm learning to reframe behavior. I'm always recognizing and reducing stressors, the ones that I can. I'm building my own stress awareness, which is a huge part of it. I got to notice it, like a sneeze coming on in myself. I've got to be able to watch for it in my kids. What can I do? What can I do? And restore energy, which is underrated. It kind of looks like it's an add-on. But for some of our kids that are struggling the most, or that we're struggling the most with, the biggest thing they need is connection with us and ways of restoring, which is more than just sleep. You know, it feels like everything is heavy all of the time. And it seems like a backwards place to start, because you want to get them to do whatever it is they're supposed to do. But it's just a different way of looking at it, and through the science. So the other thing to know is this is not within a kid. So we tend to think they need to self-regulate. As soon as I hear that, I always want to ask, how do you define self-regulation? Because they're going to tell me they basically need to manage themselves or manage their emotions. And again, self-regulated learning is really important stuff. So is social emotional learning. Stuart's done lots of work in both areas. So have I. Executive functions, or you know, being able to delay gratification, all really good stuff. But guess what they all need? Blue brain, right? And blue brain goes offline, right? If we flip our lids, all of us do. And as human beings, we're going to. We are also biologically wired for relationships. And you know, we often think of mom and child, but it's grandma and child, it's educator to kid. We can make a huge difference. It's teenagers to teens. You know, it's are that the elders and seniors in our lives, it's the connections, right? And we have, it's like this Bluetooth. So I want you to imagine that if we were to take, you know, imaging, neuroimaging, we would actually see the similar parts of the brain lit up. It's these connections, and they're not about words. You all probably know somebody that you can just give them the look, or you all know someone that I wish this person was next to me. When I'm going through a hard time, they don't say anything. They're just there. You feel differently. Your nervous system and brain knows, right? That's who we want to be for our kids. And look, if you've got older kids and they're doing this, they're also biologically programmed to separate from us. And so we've got to honor that too. And you know, it just because you're open to these connections doesn't mean they're going to be there. But you keep being open to them. You keep working through this and how we show up and how we respond. It's like the drip, drip, drip effect. Over time, it begins to have influence. How we help our child self-regulate. I realize someone is exhausted or cold or hungry, right? You know, am I just going to push through? You got to do that homework? Or am I going to say, okay, what can we do right now for a few minutes, that kind of thing. So we keep working on it, working on it, working on it. So here's a little girl who I just want you to feel her energy. And it's kind of neat to realize that that our energy affects one another. And that's not just a woo-woo idea. That's actually, you know, neurobiology, neuroscience. We're affected by the others we're around. It's the contagion effect. Don't worry. Be happy. She makes me happy. Now I want you to watch this one. I think it's a grandmother and infant, but just I want you to notice the connection. Watch the baby's face. Now, the infant is not recognizing the sign language. I'm not sure if the sign language is being taught anyway, or the infant is not deaf, is not hearing. But look at the connection, right? And the relationship, that same kind of synchrony that's where the oxytocin is released. And it actually is something that can really help kids. And look, you know what it feels like to feel felt when somebody gets you. Our kids that are struggling the most, how can we get them? How can we be the biggest cheerleader for them, even in the worst of moments? And you can say, that's not cool. Hey, I'm not thrilled about this. I love you, right? And you'd be surprised what these connections can begin to make some of a difference. So we do 5 steps. We reframe behavior. We go from this idea of they won't clean up their room. They won't do what they're supposed to do. They won't sit down. They won't do their work. You know, they won't help out. They won't be nice to their sibling. Okay, they can't. Yeah, you know, how can I be curious? What's getting in the way? What are some of the barriers? How can I begin to see this differently? You know, we move away from shame and those sorts of language that in our cultures we. You know, that's some of the ways that we try to manage behavior. This is not about going home and feeling bad about anything you've tried in the past, but just beginning to really think, okay, why did I do that? Okay, it was a stress response for me. You know, I felt bad about this, or that was not okay. And if you don't deal with it perfectly the first time, you can say sorry later. You'd be surprised what that can teach our children. But it's beginning to see them with softer eyes. And what we find is that dials down the stress on the child. And sometimes, and more over time, it begins to change some of the behaviors. We look for stressors across the five domains. So we begin to think, if our child were really dealing with the same thing over and over again, and I just need them to, right? It's like, okay. All right, if I'm going to assume that this wasn't a choice, you know, these are reactions, and that, you know, even if that's hard for me, I can accept there's more going on. And that if I could see the Fitbit of the future and see into side my child or this student's body, I would see a whirlwind of stress chemicals going on. So when we assume everything's a choice, we think that this part of the brain is made the choice. They knew exactly what they did. It was intentional, right? And the reality of things is, if we could see inside, we would see really dysregulated little people. And don't be fooled by somebody that does something not nice and just goes, or tells you, yeah, whatever. All kids want to be loved and be connected. There's some kind of a survival mechanism going on. And when we begin to see it as more, as them needing us to be that safe base, that it can really make a difference. We look at ways we can reduce the stress and the stress load. So, what can I dial down for my child? What are some things, what are our points of tension? Getting out the door every day, Monday mornings, summer vacation, whatever. Like, there's no real right or wrong. But with my daughter, it used to be the day that she came back from her dad, you know, 3 or 4 days away with her dad. Her biological dad, and it would be always, right? So what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? And realizing that they're having a hard time, not giving you a hard time. So this is just one thing you could try if you feel like it, if you wanted to try a little bit of self-reg in practice. So you could consider this a strategy, I guess. But have a look around your home, or it could be a certain room of your home, or a place where there's a lot of tension that happens all the time, a certain room in the house. Make it be one that is yours, not, we're not trying to put this on our kids. We're trying to think, okay, what might make a difference? And this isn't about spending money at all. And it's certainly not about, decluttering can help, but it's not actually trying to put more weight on your shoulders. It's just really thinking, okay, I chose to not have a TV in my main room. You might find it busy behind me with all my plants, but they make me happy. The fireplace makes me happy. And this room has become a really nice family room where I lived before here, the TV dominated it. So I made that choice. And I had a lot of pushback, right? But I made that choice. So it can be looking around lighting. It can be looking, it could be looking at how certain things are set up for function. It could be thinking about sounds. There's no real right or wrong. You're just kind of standing back and beginning to think about that. Okay, if I wanted to dial down stress and the environment in that, what could I do, right? And even if it's just little things that make a difference, we also have to ask ourselves, okay, where am I in the mix? Am I my child does and I go, whoa. Or if you're educators online, I know there's some educators that have joined in, the kid does something you don't like and right on. It's like, okay, maybe, I'm not suggesting no expectations. But we also realizing are we reacting or are we in a state where we're choosing how we respond, right? So it's a really interesting one to think about. So I'm only going to show you a minute of this video. I personally find it quite dysregulating, but I wanted to share it because it's an example that we may not think of as how we could be escalating, how we could be a stressor for a kid. So it's a mom and her kid. So it goes on quite a while, and mom is clearly having a day and tuning her out. Maybe mom is always like that. Maybe mom is truly just having a day. But I want you to notice the little girl. What it is she needs connection. there's research coming out, there's research happening around this idea of constant partial attention, that where we feel like we're with our kids more, but we're actually on our phone. You know, one of the things I did in my family that made a really big difference, because mornings were nuts. And I have my kid, but I take in different kids. There's more than a few here. And I realized that I was on my phone sometimes. So I put my phone away in the morning, and that made a really big difference just for a little bit. And you might think, right, it's them. Well, how can we think about that differently, right? How is that happening, the point of tension? What's happening when we're saying, you need to, why didn't you every day? Okay. How can I come at this in a different kind of way? So that's a piece of it as well. Here is step four of self-reg, and it is reflect. It's like noticing a sneeze coming on. I don't always notice when I'm going to go red brain. So if I'm going to, suddenly get very frustrated with someone, I do it less and less thanks to, you know, years and years of practicing this, but it still happens. Or I feel myself say, you know, right, but whatever. It's okay. So it just happened. And I can reflect afterwards. But a lot of times I'm in situations, I'm trying to think, okay, calm, genuine listening, right? And to trying to hear, you know, what the other person is trying to say. But also I watch, you know, the signs. What am I seeing about the signs of stress states? An awareness of my own body, because if I'm like this and I'm all rigid, that's actually cueing my child or whoever's in front of me to be in threat. So clear, calm, listening, embodied awareness, and reflection. So calm is your superpower, and I want you to think about it like when their storm meets your calm. That's co-regulation, and I'm going to show you this little example. I'm just going to turn the sound off because how they describe it is like a choice, be brave. So there's a car that comes across, and the little fawn is down on the ground frozen. It's a paralysis that hits it. It's in brain and body all the time. And what does mom do? Mom cues safety. So the video, whoever's taking is talking about, she's telling her to be brave. No, it's cued enough safety that the child can, you know, that the fawn can respond. So what do we do when our kid walks in the door and is screaming and crying, you know, about they've fallen down and hurt themselves, or they're fighting with someone, or our kids are, you know, we have siblings and something, you know, some kind of big blowout has happened. How do we respond in that moment? And often that's a great place to insert the pause if you can. Before we jump in and, you know, we can actually escalate things. Okay. So I'm not suggesting not creating safety. And I realize that happens, but so often we get in there with our voice in the moment or with our judgment. And it's really beginning to be aware of our calm. We can't lend calm if we're not calm. And we're not calm when we're out of homeostasis, when we're out of that balance, right? So here's one strategy. We cue safety. It's just the acronym safety. You simplify your language, and often it's no words. Words can come. There's lots of moments. I talk a lot. There's lots of life lessons and moments and talking things through. But in the moment, I know that their brain's not even processing those, and maybe their parts of their ear that are needed to even hear may not even be online. Simplify your language, attune. So that just means notice and try to synchronize yourself a little bit to that emotional state, right? Frustration at the big box store because you didn't buy the candy. You know, do I say, oh, I'm going to buy you the candy because that's so dysregulating for you? No, but I have respect if I don't think that's the right thing and that's not what I'm going to do. But I can honor my child and realize that first of all, marketers are trying to hook a child, which they are, but also that was disappointment, and disappointment is a big energy expensive emotion. So I have compassion for that child. So it's how I say no, and I understand that's very disappointing for you. Do you need a hug? or I love you or whatever, right? Totally different response. And you might do it with a teenager and they're just going to be, right? It's the same response. No, and I understand that's frustrating for you. And the answer is no. And I love you, right? So take your time. So again, when you have, you know, we don't have to rush in all the time. And so sometimes moving slowly, somebody that is in a real, you know, threat response, will be on guard for every movement, right? So really thinking about that, I often sit down, can make a big difference, and just trust in the best intentions, even if it looks the worst. So this is number five of self-reg. It's about restoring energy. And, it, you know, in a way, all of the other steps are about arriving at genuine restoration. But this isn't just doing some yoga or meditating. Some people who practice self-reg do those, but some people don't. I like yoga, intense yoga, but not, you know, meditating. I can't focus on it, right? So we have different ways that we restore. And that we've got to think about the things that are genuinely restorative. So looking up at last night, the sunset was beautiful. And I have a bit of a sense of awe around it. I love gardening. I used to kill everything, but now I seem to be the real green. I love it, and the awe every time something comes up. You know, these moments of cuddling with our kids, if we can find them. If you have kids that don't cuddle anymore and you get a moment, take it, right? So all of these things are restorative. And really think naturally regulating practices. So that just means these are the things that you or your child wants to do, not are doing because they have to. I should go for a walk in the woods. The woods are great. But what are the things you really want to do? And trying to look for ways to get more restoration in there. Because our brain and body, it's a parasympathetic system. That's where it's our rest and our digest. It's tied to our metabolism and weight. It's tied to our immune system health. It's tied to memory. All these things that need us to be in restorative in these states of parasympathetic states don't happen if we're not there. And if we've got our phone on at, you know, 11 at night, and then we go to bed and it's on notifying us all night long, we never get into that deep enough sleep. That we're getting into this genuine restoration. I guard sleep. So it's one of the most important things that you can do. I know you can't make a kid sleep. You can try. But what are the things that you can do around that? So here are just a couple of strategies to finish with you. I'll do some more next time. But prioritize healthy routines. So I know everybody's routines. Look at your routines. Really have a look at them. And it's good to have routines. You want to also have some flexibility. You know, things change. There's certain days. The weather is sometimes quite magical. Is there a little bit of flexibility in that? But healthy routines are anchoring if we don't have to think through them each time. Rituals. So if you're reading with your kid, if you have young children, or storytelling is another lovely one, right? You can tell the same stories over and over again. Storytelling is a terrific one. But some of these rituals are coming together. So it's not just a routine. It's a we time coming together, right? And so some of the things that, even if it's just getting, I have this acronym for, it's called we time, but it's just really about making sure, you know, finding 15 minutes a day with your kid in some kind of way that doesn't have phones, doesn't have technology, you know, some kind of way of just being together. Look for the strengths, especially if you've got a child that's in trouble all the time, or in trouble with you, or in trouble somewhere else. These are the kids that need us to see the best in them and need us to advocate for others to see the best in them. So laughter, you know, and you might think, well, they don't deserve that. Oh yeah, they do. They're dealing with so much. They don't know the reactions are coming out of them. The behaviors, we don't have to say great job. We're saying these are problems. All of these things are happening are problems. But how are we going to solve them? We're not going to solve them with more nagging kind of thing, right? That kind of idea, even rewards and punishments. You've all probably tried them. They work and then they don't, right? Beginning to think though, we've got healthy routines. We're teaching kids about boundaries just by how we set up our own. We're getting support for us if we need it. I've done that. There's no shame in that. That's what we do, right? But then it's really trying to make sure there's some well, healthy, joyful moments. And if you're not getting it reciprocated, you could still keep giving it, right? And you'd be surprised, it begins, it's sinking in, and you may not see that for a little while, but it's sinking in. Find your softer eyes for kids, for other parents. You know, some of you are dealing with, you know, parents-in-law and all that, with all the different advice of these things, right? So how can I really see differently? My biggest strategy for that is really recognizing that the other person really does have the best intentions of the kids in mind. I have very few exceptions that I can think of someone, and I can think of people that had completely different ideas about kids than I did, and really harsh ideas, and that I would love to banish and not have happen. And yet I had to find a way to come together. And so I can begin to say, okay, they really believe this is what's best for kids, right? That the school of so-called hard knocks or whatever, right? And for ourselves, it's one of the most important, compassion for ourselves. We're human. Many of us on here are doing way more than our share in all kinds of different areas, right? It's not selfish to take care of your, to take a few moments for yourself. It's the most generous thing you can give to the people you love. It's not always easy, I know. 5 minutes here and there. Do 5-cent scans. Just stand in a room in your house and close your eyes. See what you notice, smell, see some of the sounds, right? Begin to think about it, it can help you begin to notice stressors. I'm not a huge fan of timeouts. There's a lot of science against timeouts. The Pediatricians of Canada have done a joint letter advocating against timeouts. The reason is, it says my interbrain, our connection, is contingent on your behavior. And, you know, we've moved beyond real behaviorist ideas to trying to shape behavior, because we brain's no longer a black box. Like, that we're a couple decades beyond that. The one person I do take timeouts for is me, right? So think about how different a message that is, though, to a kid. It's like, I need a few minutes. I need a few minutes just to get feeling better. I'm not ready to deal with this right now. Very different. Time fours, put in the work on the front end. You know, I spent a lot of time with my kid with dishwasher messy, having to redo everything. She's a great at the dishwasher. Like, there's, it begins to have its ripple effects. Practice the why and why now. It's a reflective pause. When you notice yourself feeling judgmental, or you notice yourself feeling triggered, there's a certain kinds of people, just because of my, you know, my rough start was also partly from, you know, kind of dysfunctional family in part, I guess. And people that reminded me of my father, would they still do. I loved him, but it was not easy, and it can trigger, and, you know, very controlling kind of things. So back up against the wall and just go, why am I now? Or sometimes we're just picking up something and we don't know what it is. Sometimes it's us, you know, even the hangry idea. I'm hungry. Oh, look, I thought it was this other thing, and I need food, right? So really beginning to do that. We scaffold, so that's language from education, but when we want our kid is going to learn to read over their, you know, first whatever, however many years of life, and you don't have to be in the huge race for that. The research is not backing up that the kid who started to read at 3 is necessarily further ahead. It should be a joyful, that ritual time. Time together, it's not just about the reading. It actually is very, it's a lovely co-regulation time, right? But we scaffold that, right? We need a little bit over time, and gradually, you know, it's kind of a magical thing if you've ever been part of it. We need to do that with self-regulation too. So being able to handle difficult things, able to handle the stress of difficult things, of no's, of failures, of things that went wrong, all of that is about self-regulation, managing stress. And lots of kids are doing it naturally. There's no readiness for it. Stuart had an autism center, and the kids at 3, they didn't use any of the words necessarily, but they were able to notice when the sneeze was coming on, and had certain strategies that were individualized. He talks about one kid who used to do jumping jacks, right? It's not necessarily what you think it's going to be, right? But it's over time. And one of the things I do with the kids that really struggle with this, kids that have, you know, have trauma histories, you know, for example, that their systems can be primed for limbic responses on edge, because our brains adapt to our environments. And even when that environment changes, the brain is still adapting to that. There's lots of, sensory sensitivities is another one, that it's, it might go with other diagnoses and it might not. But if you're somebody that has auditory sensory sensitivities or there's some people with smells and it's everywhere, like you're dealing with that all the time, right? So we begin to think about, okay, why am I now? And how can I look at this as being the scaffold, helping a child or a human or another person notice, well, look at that strategy that really worked for you, right? So helping begin to look at it like that. Noticing when you get the shoulda, coulda, wouldas coming out, those are self-control. So the should, the should, could, woulds, and model loops. You're not perfect. You're never going to be, I'm not perfect. And it's okay to share that. Kids can learn from that and they'll respect you for it. Am I saying say sorry for every little thing? No. When you didn't handle something great, say, I didn't handle that great. I wish I'd have handled that differently. And it is a gift. It is a gift to our kids. So, you are the strategy. This doesn't mean it's all on your shoulders. That means that, there are a bunch of strategies, which I'll show you next time. And you can do some of them, and some of them will work some of the time. But there's no program. There's no colored carts here. It's a different way of thinking. Reframe behavior. Recognize stressors. Okay, why and why now? What are the stressors? What can I do to dial down a bit of stress? When my child shows me there's too much going on, and they show me because they're not handling it, what can I dial down? And it's okay to still have expectations, of course. When my daughter went through a really hard time a couple of years ago, COVID related, and anxiety and panic attacks and things, and she didn't want to go to school anymore. And I'm like, whoa, right? So I took away some of the expectations on her, because I wanted her to go to school. And then those expectations, chores and those kind of things were lightened, came back on. So amplify positive emotions. Remember, they need the positivity. It's not just about coping. It's about well-being and joy and strengths. And your self-reg matters too. So these are our eight values, and it's not a program. It's for everyone. There is expertise. There's cultural, all kinds of cultural practices from, especially from our past, that used to be just part of different families and different communities that have gone out the window, that we're actually regulating practices in all kinds of natural ways. So it is universal. It's not just for that kid, and it's about all of us.